Welcome to our Maundy Thursday service. I hope that this experience will bring you into the presence of Christ on this one of the most sacred nights of the year. Maundy Thursday, the word comes from the same source as our word mandate, because in the course of this night, Jesus says he gives us a new commandment or a new mandate. I invite you to listen and see if you can discover just what it is. You will, through the course of this evening, be invited, if you wish, to partake of communion. You can do that in any way that you want to. So if you wish to go now and get bread or something to drink, you can do that, especially if you have someone to share it with. You might even want to get a wet towel and practice washing one another's feet or washing one another's hands. All of those things you are free to do this evening. This is a taped service, so you can stop it at any time, start over. You can experience it in any way that you wish. I wish that we could be together to experience this with one another, but my prayer is that it will be meaningful to you where you are this night. May God bless you as we worship together.
Holy Week is the preparation for Easter. We're taking the week to do it and really pausing at different points in the week to reflect on different places and periods of time in the last week of Jesus' life. We, at Maundy Thursday, remember this time that Jesus spent with his disciples in the upper room and offered them bread and wine, his body and blood. Maundy is a strange word. We don't use it for anything in our time. It comes from the Latin mandante, which is talking about this washing of feet. In our liturgy, you know, this enters in at some churches in a symbolic way. Some people choose one or two people's feet to wash, or a whole congregation may wash feet. I think using an ancient word points us to the fact that this is a long-standing practice in the church. And then I also love the fact that Jesus says, you don't understand what I'm doing. And so that kind of gives me a way in, like I don't have to understand this thing to participate, but I'm just supposed to experience it and be in this moment. I think that liturgy is a way we enter into the realm between here and heaven. I mean, we are telling a story, the story of Jesus, his betrayal, his death and resurrection, waiting for his coming again. And we're reminding each other that we are waiting together. And for me, liturgy is a way to enter into the time that has passed and the time that will come.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence, living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word I'm desperate for you. Cry out to him, I'm desperate for you. Cry out to him, I'm desperate without you.
Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through 13. The festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was approaching. The chief priests and the legal experts were looking for a way to kill Jesus because they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered Judas called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went out and discussed with the chief priests and the officers of the temple guard how he could hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted and arranged payment for him. He agreed and began looking for an opportunity to hand Jesus over to them, a time when the crowds would be absent. The day of unleavened bread arrived, when the Passover had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John with this task: "Go and prepare for us to eat the Passover meal." They said to him, "Where do you want us to prepare it?" Jesus replied, "When you go into the city, a man carrying a water jar will meet you. Follow him to the house he enters. Say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room already furnished. Make preparations there." They went and found everything just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover.
The Bible says that we are to tell the Exodus story to our children in every generation. "You shall tell your son in that day, saying, 'It is because of that which Adonai did for me when I went forth out of Egypt.' Jacob brought his family to Egypt to be with his son Joseph, who had become viceroy, second to the king of all Egypt. Over time, the children of Israel multiplied in the land of Egypt. Pharaoh feared, because the Israelites were becoming too many and too mighty. He started to oppress and enslave them as a way of weakening them. The Israelites were forced to build cities, erect monuments, construct roads, work in the quarries, and hew stones. Despite all this, the Israelites continued to grow in numbers. So Pharaoh passed a law that all male babies of Jewish mothers be killed. Jacob's great-grandson, Amram, who married Jocheved, had a daughter, Miriam, and a son named Aaron. Jocheved gave birth to a third child. To save him from being killed by the Pharaoh's soldiers, she placed him in a basket which she hid among the reeds at the edge of the Nile River. When Pharaoh's daughter came to bathe in the Nile, she discovered the baby. She called the baby Moses, which means drawn from water, and decided to raise him herself in the palace. She hired the baby's mother, Jocheved, to be his nurse. As Moses grew, Jocheved taught him about his Jewish heritage. The suffering of the enslaved Jewish people increased. When Moses was 80 years old and his brother Aaron was 83 years old, they entered the palace of King Pharaoh to deliver a message. "The God of Israel said, 'Let my people go, that they may serve me.'" Pharaoh did not believe in the God of Israelites, and he refused to let his Jewish slaves go free. When Pharaoh continued to refuse to liberate the children of Israel, Moses and Aaron warned him that God would punish both him and his people with plagues. First, the waters of the land of Egypt turned into blood. Then the entire land was covered by the plague of frogs. The third plague had lice crawling forth from the dust to cover all of Egypt. Despite the plagues, Pharaoh refused to let the Israelites go. The fourth plague consisted of hordes of wild animals roving all over the country, destroying everything in their path. After this plague, Pharaoh promised to let the Jews go on condition that they would not go too far. Moses prayed to God, and the wild animals disappeared. But as soon as they had gone, Pharaoh changed his mind and decided not to let the Jewish slaves go free. Then God sent the fifth plague, a fatal pestilence that killed most of the domestic animals of the Egyptians. In the sixth plague, boils burst forth upon man and beast throughout Egypt. Now Moses announced to Pharaoh that a violent hailstorm would kill everything that was outside and not sheltered. Pharaoh started to relent and agreed to let the Jewish men go free, but Pharaoh insisted that the Jewish women and children and all their possessions remain in Egypt. Moses and Aaron could not accept this offer. With the eighth plague, swarms of locusts devoured everything green that had escaped the hail and the previous plagues. The ninth plague was a blanket of darkness that enveloped all of Egypt except for Goshen, where the children of Israel lived. Finally, at midnight on the 15th of Nisan, all firstborn in the land of Egypt began dying, including the firstborn of King Pharaoh, exactly as Moses had warned. At this point, Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron and said to them, "Arise, go out from among my people, both you and the children of Israel, and go. Serve God as you have said. Go, and bless me also." The Jews departed in haste. They assembled in families or groups to eat the roasted Passover lamb and the unleavened bread. Then, after the sun rose on the 15th day of the Hebrew month of Nisan, the Jewish nation rose together to leave the land of Egypt. After 3 days, Pharaoh started to regret that he had permitted the Israelites to leave. He mobilized his army in hot pursuit of his former slaves. He reached them near the banks of the Red Sea. Moses led the Israelites onwards until they came to the very borders of the Red Sea. Then God spoke to Moses. "Lift up your rod, stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go into the midst of the sea on dry ground." Moses did as God ordered. Then a strong east wind blew all night, and the waters of the Red Sea divided. The Israelites marched along a dry path through the Red Sea until they reached the opposite side in safety. The Egyptians continued their pursuit, but the waters of the Red Sea closed over them and drowned Pharaoh's army. Thus, God liberated the children of Israel from the Egyptians, and the children of Israel saw God's great power and believed in Him. The story of Passover recounts the birth of the Jewish people as a nation whose ultimate goal is to be a light unto the nations.
Luke, chapter 22, verses 14 through 23. When the time came, Jesus took his place at the table, and the apostles joined him. He said to them, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I tell you, I won't eat it again until it is fulfilled in God's realm." After taking a cup and giving thanks, he said, "Take this and share it among yourselves. I tell you that from now on I won't drink from the fruit of the vine until God's reign has come." After taking the bread and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after the meal and said, "This cup is the new covenant by my blood, which is poured out for you. But look, my betrayer is with me. His hand is on the table. The human one goes just as it has been determined. But how terrible it is for that person who betrays him." They began to argue among themselves, about which one of them it could possibly be who would do this. May God add a blessing to this reading.
In remembrance of me, eat this bread. In remembrance of me, drink this wine. In remembrance of me, pray for the time when God's own will is done. In remembrance of me, heal the sick. In remembrance of me, feed the poor. In remembrance of me, open the door and let your brother in. Let him in. Take, eat, and be comforted. Drink and remember that this is my body and precious blood shed for you, shed for you. In remembrance of me, search for truth. In remembrance of me, always love. In remembrance of me, don't look above, but in your heart, in your heart, look in your heart. For God, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. In remembrance of me.
Loving God, for all your good gifts, we give you thanks. Even in the midst of difficult days such as these, we seek to be grateful because gratitude and grace is all that will get us through. On this day, Maundy, when we hear the new commandment of Jesus, give us courage to fulfill the mandate to love one another. Even when it is difficult, even when we are in difficult straits, bad places, a negative frame of mind, help us to find the grace and gratitude to still be grateful to you and graceful to each other. O God, as we are nourished by this meal, we pray that your Spirit will nourish our hearts and souls. Help us not to betray you in who we are and how we live and what we say, and most especially in how we treat one another. May this new mandate to love as you loved be fulfilled in our lives, beginning here and now, through the rest of our days. In your many names we pray. Amen.
Out beyond ideas of being and right doing, there is a field.
John chapter 13, verses 1 through 35. Before the festival of Passover, Jesus knew that his time had come to leave this world and return to God. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them fully. Jesus and his disciples were sharing the evening meal. The devil had already provoked Judas, Simon Iscariot's son, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that God had given everything into his hands and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the table and took off his robes. Picking up a linen towel, he tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he was wearing. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You don't understand what I am doing now, but you will understand it later." No, said Peter, you will never wash my feet. Jesus replied, unless I wash you, you won't have a place with me. Simon Peter said, Lord, not only my feet, but my hands and my head. Jesus responded, those who have bathed need only to have their feet washed because they are completely clean. You disciples are clean, but not every one of you. He knew who would betray him. That's why he said, not every one of you is clean. After he washed the disciples' feet, he put his robes back on and returned to his place at the table. He said to them, do you know what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you speak correctly because I am. If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you too must wash each other's feet. I have given you an example. Just as I have done, you also must do. I assure you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are those who are sent greater than the one who sent them. Since you know these things, you will be happy if you do them. I am not speaking about all of you. I know those whom I have chosen, but this is to fulfill the scripture, quote, the one who eats my bread has turned against me. I am telling you this now, before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am. I assure you that whoever receives someone I send receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. After he said these things, Jesus was deeply disturbed and testified, I assure you, one of you will betray me. His disciples looked at one another, confused about which one he was talking about. One of the disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, was at Jesus' side. Simon Peter nodded at him to get him to ask Jesus who he was talking about. Leaning back toward Jesus, the disciple asked, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it's the one whom I give this piece of bread once I have dipped it into the bowl. Then he dipped the piece of bread and gave it to Judas, Simon Iscariot's son. After Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. Jesus told him, what you are about to do, do quickly. No one sitting at the table understood why Jesus said this to him. Some thought that since Jesus kept the money bag, Jesus told him, go and buy what we need for the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. So when Judas took the bread, he left immediately, and it was night. When Judas was gone, Jesus said, now the human one has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify the human one in God's self and will glorify him immediately. Little children, I am with you just a little while longer. You will look for me, just as I have told the Jewish leaders. I also tell you, where I am going, you can't come. But I give you a new commandment, a new mandate. Love one another. Just as I have loved you, so you must love one another. This is how everyone will know you are my disciples, when you love one another. May God add a blessing to this reading. Amen. Luke chapter 22, verses 39 through 54. Jesus left and made his way to the Mount of Olives, as was his custom, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived, he said to them, pray that you won't give in to temptation. He withdrew from them about a stone's throw away and knelt down and prayed. He said, Abba, if it be your will, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not my will, but your will must be done. Then a heavenly angel appeared to him and strengthened him. He was in anguish and prayed even more earnestly. His sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he got up from where he was praying, he went to the disciples and found them asleep. Overcome by grief, he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you won't give in to temptation." While Jesus was still speaking, a crowd appeared, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him. Jesus said to him, "Judas, would you betray the human one with a kiss?" When those around him recognized what was happening, they said, "Lord, should we fight with our swords?" One of them struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. Jesus responded, "Stop. No more of this." He touched the slave's ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests and officers of the temple guard and the elders who had come to get him, "Have you come with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a thief? Day after day I was with you in the temple, but you didn't arrest me. But this is your time, when darkness rules." After they arrested Jesus, they led him away and brought him to the high priest's house. May God add a blessing to this sacred reading.
Thief was
supposed